Hi, my name is Anna. I'm a watershed education specialist at the Cedar River Watershed. Do you know where your water comes from? The water you use every day to shower, flush the toilet, wash dishes, do laundry, and drink? Most people in the United States don't think about it because water just comes out of the faucet when you turn it on. But there's much more to it than that. Water is everywhere on the planet. It creates oceans, lakes, rivers, water vapor, ice caps, and glaciers. Water is in the ground, plants, animals, and people. All living things need fresh water to survive. But there's not a lot of fresh water on the planet. 70% of the Earth's surface is covered with water. However, more than 97% of that water is salt water, and over 2% is frozen in ice caps and glaciers. That leaves less than 1% of all the water on the planet to be shared by all living creatures. That's quite a job! To complicate matters, the amount of water on the planet doesn't increase or decrease, it stays the same. The amount of water on the planet is the same as when the dinosaurs roamed the Earth. If there's such a small amount of fresh water available for living creatures, and humans use a lot of water, how do we have a continuous source of clean and reliable water? It's because of the planet Earth's grand recycling program called the water cycle. In the water cycle, water changes forms between liquid, solid as in ice, and gas as in water vapor. There are many parts of the water cycle, but today we are just going to review 7 main parts. The sun is a critical part of the water cycle. It heats up water drops on the Earth's surface in places such as lakes, ponds, puddles, and rivers until they turn into water vapor and start going up in the sky. This is called evaporation. Evaporating water travels up into the atmosphere where it is colder than the surface of the Earth. The water vapor comes together to form larger water drops that make clouds. That's condensation. As more and more water vapor condenses into clouds, the clouds become heavier and heavier until they release water droplets in the form of snow, sleet, hail, or rain. What's this part of the cycle called? If you guess precipitation, you're right. Precipitation falls down to the earth. As rain falls or snow, sleet, and hail melt, it flows downhill as runoff. Runoff eventually collects in lakes, streams, ponds, and puddles. We call this accumulation. Some of the runoff soaks into the ground and is then known as groundwater. And then the sun starts the cycle all over again. It's amazing! Do you remember all parts of the water cycle we just talked about? There's sun, evaporation, condensation, precipitation, runoff, accumulation, and groundwater. The water cycle moves water around the planet so that all living creatures have water to survive. In the United States, people either get the water they use every day from surface water that is accumulated in lakes and rivers, or from groundwater. People use wells to reach water that is stored underground. Chances are, if you live in the greater Seattle area, your water comes from one of two pristine lakes in the Cascade Mountains. These lakes are called Chester Morris Lake, which is in the Cedar River watershed, and the South Fork Tolt Reservoir, which is in the Tolt River watershed. Together, they provide reliable, clean water for 1.5 million people, maybe even you. There's a really small amount of fresh water on the planet that's always on the move through the water cycle. Thanks to the water cycle and Seattle Public Utilities, water is always there when you turn on the faucet.